co-chair of the Food System Caucus, and I represent the Senate on the Food Policy Council. We have folks from five counties today tuning in to hear this progress report from the White House Conference on Hunger, Nutrition, and Health, given by our remarkable friend and Congressman Jim McGovern. I want to raise up the group of organizations who had the privilege of attending or being connected to the conference and who are co-hosting or co-organizing today. They hail from the Food Bank of Western Massachusetts, Growing Places, Stone Soup Cafe, CESA, Springfield Food Policy Council, the Massachusetts Food System Collaborative, and Project Bread. From the legislature and from the Food System Caucus, I'm really glad to be joined today by my co-chair, the rocking representative, Mindy Dom. Our goal for today is to create a space for participants to learn about the call to action from the conference to end hunger in the Commonwealth and in Western Massachusetts by 2030, to tackle diet-related diseases and strengthen our food system and farms in the process. So three things: end hunger by 2030, tackle diet-related diseases like hypertension and obesity, and strengthen our food system and farms in the process. We also want to help participants take away concrete and timely action steps around critical budget priorities and policy proposals that are going to move the Commonwealth boldly toward ending hunger in just a handful of years. And finally, we hope that today helps surface and honor a broad group of experts and advocates in this region, you all on this Zoom, who are doing unbelievable work. As Liz Ogilvy from the Springfield Food Policy Council says, there's a lot of good already happening, and it's important that we celebrate it. So we have a packed agenda, and in a moment, we're going to hear from Jim, and then we'll hear from folks who were at the conference, and then we'll hear from three folks with concrete action steps, leaving time for your thoughts and questions. A big love to Zoe from CESA and Laura from the Food Bank. Thanks to them, we're going to be monitoring the chat and collecting your questions and thoughts for that end of this Zoom together. We'll raise them up then. And now it's just a privilege to turn it over to Congressman McGovern. So folks who were tuning in to the White House conference, or folks who were there, know that our Congressman Jim McGovern had a standing ovation for his work leading in the lead up to, during, and now following the White House conference. He was universally cheered, and it was deafening and long because everybody recognized that Jim alone has really carried the flame for ending hunger, that he knows that hunger and food insecurity is solvable in this nation. And it is just such an honor to see the man work. And he is tireless. I'm not sure how he stretches a day as far as he does, but his peers in Congress, the Biden administration, and all the advocates at the conference recognized Jim McGovern as the leader of that conference and gave him the thanks and love that he was due, like we get to give him because he is our guy. So Jim, I'm going to turn it over to you. I know you hate gushing, but it's really something that we are so proud of and so grateful to you for.
Well, first of all, thank you for the gushing. I appreciate it. And I admire the work of Senator Comerford so much on this and so many other issues. And so I'm really grateful for the kind introduction, and I'm grateful to have lawmakers like you and the incredible Mindy Dom, who I see on the call. I'm thrilled. We feel lucky to have you at the State House fighting every day to make sure that communities in Western Massachusetts thrive and that every family in every corner of the state has access to good, nutritious food. You all are champions for food security, and I'm grateful to call you friends, and to the other presenters, Liz, Kirsten, Ann, Erin, Laura, Winton, Phil, thank you. I'm grateful to be from Massachusetts, and I'm grateful to represent Western Massachusetts because of partners like you. And I'm, looking at all the faces here and all the people that represented. Thank you for all of your incredible work. And a lot of the work that is being done locally really has been the inspiration for me to push for the White House conference and to push for changes in some of our policies nationally. And so, I have other members of Congress, my colleagues, who are envious that I get to work with you and represent people like you. And I tell them that we just need to fight harder. We don't need to reinvent the wheel. Some of the really important stuff that needs to be done is happening right here in Massachusetts. So I also want to thank the Food Bank of Western Massachusetts for hosting today's gathering so that we can continue working together toward a hunger-free America, starting here in Western Massachusetts. Love, love, love the Food Bank and the entire team at the Food Bank. Look, it has been 6 months since the Biden-Harris administration hosted the second ever White House conference on hunger, nutrition, and health. The first and only one other than this one was held over 50 years ago, 1969, the year we put somebody on the moon. And this conference was a long time in coming. And out of this conference came an ambitious but achievable roadmap to end hunger and reduce diet-related disease by the year 2030. I really believe that this conference has the potential to be transformational, that this conference has the potential to impact more change than the conference that occurred in 1969 did. And as you know, WIC came out of that, and the kind of the modern day SNAP program, and even food labeling was came out of that. So many important things. But I think that this conference, if we do the follow through, has the potential to be have even a greater impact on this country. And this national strategy calls for a whole of society response to end hunger, which, we all know that that's what it takes. But quite frankly, to have the President of the United States get up and to say that is important, because so much of the work in this area has been siloed. You know, we talk about SNAP, well, that's the Farm Bill and the Ag Committee. You talk about school meals, well, that's the Education Committee. You talk about food as medicine, well, that's Energy and Commerce or Ways and Means. And we just haven't, in terms of government, haven't gotten everybody together. But in addition to that, it is not just the federal government, it is the state and local government. In addition to that, it is also the nonprofit sector, the private sector. We have to look at entire systems. And they need to be adjusted and changed. The national strategy, as I said, calls for a whole of society response to end hunger. And in the months following the conference, Congress has got to work on some of the priorities that were laid out in the strategy. We created a permanent summer EBT program to give families with kids, $40 per child per month over the summer, when we know that hunger is often worse. I mean, it's a small step in the right direction, but it's an important step in the right direction. And especially during these times of high inflation, and especially in the aftermath of the boost up in SNAP, as the pandemic boost being cut, this is really, really, really crucial. We responded to the crisis of EBT skimming by requiring benefit replacement for those who have had their SNAP benefits stolen through no fault of their own. That provision, by the way, originated with conversations between local advocates here in Massachusetts. That change is direct. This improvement, this adjustment has come because of people in Massachusetts. We mandated that the Department of Defense screen military families for food insecurity and train professionals at military installations on where to refer families in need. We know that, their hunger is a problem amongst active duty service members. And that is why there are food pantries near almost every military base in this country. We passed my legislation, the Food Donation Improvement Act, to help make it easier for retailers, manufacturers, farmers, and schools to donate food directly to hungry people. We passed a massive omnibus spending bill that includes the highest level of non-defense spending in history. That translates into robust funding for WIC, farm to school grants, school meal equipment grants, among other things. The bill funded other priorities laid out in the national strategy, like major increases in funding to support affordable childcare and safe housing. I mean, there's obviously much, much, much more that needs to be done in these areas. But we're off to a good start. And there is finally momentum at a national level behind efforts to end hunger. I mean, we have people in the administration saying that we want to end hunger. I mean, that's all part of our vocabulary, but in the White House over the years, and even in Congress, that is not part of their vocabulary. That is changing. You know, at the White House conference, President Biden made clear that it is the priority of the federal government to end hunger in this decade, and we must aggressively implement the national strategy. So the budget release last week from the president featured several items from the conference, including an expansion of community eligibility and medically tailored meals pilot that I've been pushing for. While we still need Congress to act on these items, I took it as a good sign that the administration certainly isn't giving up on the goal of ending hunger and reducing diet-related diseases by the end of the decade. So in Congress, I recently introduced a legislation to permanently increase the reimbursement rates paid by the federal government to schools for every breakfast and every lunch served. And it is important because we talk a lot about the quality of food that we provide our kids in school, but we also talk about the importance of supporting our local farmers. With a little bit extra money, more money for breakfast and lunch, it gives school districts and people who oversee school meals some flexibility to do some things, you know, that might right now they don't do because it's too complicated or might cost a little bit more. So we're going to be pushing that. We also have been working toward getting medically tailored meals pilot up and running. You know, we know that one of the number one reasons why people get readmitted to hospitals after major surgeries is lack of nutrition. Oftentimes people are weakened from whatever they had done to them in the hospital and they don't eat. They end up back in the hospital. We need to advance this pilot so we can actually make medically tailored meals, you know, part of not only Medicare, but part of getting insurance companies to buy into it as well. The Agriculture Committee's work on the 2023 Farm Bill is just getting started. And and no surprise, but Republicans are targeting SNAP. They're spreading all kinds of disinformation, which they do really, really well. And so we're going to have to fight to prevent cuts to the program and prevent them from putting in place more hurdles that will make it more difficult for people who need the benefit to get the benefit. I mean, this is nothing new. They do it every farm bill. But I think one of the things that we have to do to combat this is we have to start telling stories about who the people are on the program and what it means to them and how essential it is for them and their families. They're going after what we call the ABOD population, in particular the able-bodied adults without dependents, and again they have no idea who this population is. I mean, this population includes veterans, it includes people who are, you know, just graduating from foster care. It includes people who are dealing with medical issues and mental health issues that have not been diagnosed. It includes a wide range of people that all of us would agree should not lose their benefit. And so we're going to have that battle. We're hearing that the attack on SNAP may not just be in the Farm Bill, but in the Appropriations Committee as well. There's a target on this program by the Republicans on the Appropriation Committee. So we need to remain vigilant, and we need to remain unified against any cuts. And I'm hopeful that we can hold the line on that, but we're going to have to work it. Republicans are going to have the pen in terms of writing the Farm Bill in the House, but not in the Senate, and we still have the administration. So, you know, we need to make sure that as much of the national strategy is folded into the Farm Bill as possible and other legislation. So my top Farm Bill priorities include protecting the updated benefit calculation implemented by the Biden-Harris administration in 2021, the Thrifty Food Plan, which is something that they want to go after, expanding Double Up Bucks incentives through the GUS SNP program, which helps get people access to more nutritious food also helps our farmers, and making hot foods eligible for SNAP. I mean, you know, it has become increasingly clear to me as we have done hearings all throughout the country that prepared foods, hot meals, you know, need to be addressed in SNAP. People's lives are complicated, and we need to understand that. So we're going to be working on that. We also want to include work on improving college student eligibility for SNAP and permanently eliminating the time limit for able-bodied adults, which does nothing to incentivize work or just makes poor adults hungrier. While we're doing that, it's important that state and local elected officials and anti-hunger organizations also scale up their work in line with the national strategy. And as I've been saying, everywhere I go, please do not wait for Congress. The national strategy lays out actions that can be taken by the private sector and by every level of government. And here in Massachusetts, I'm pleased that we're organizing to draft a statewide plan to end hunger. I mean, thank you to Project Bread for pulling that group together. Please count me in as a partner. I'm looking forward to continuing to work with local elected officials, state legislators, and the Healy Driscoll administration to make universal free school meals permanent, to increase investment in the Healthy Incentives Program, and to continue our work to expand access to food as medicine initiatives like medically tailored meals and the work under the 1115 Medicaid waiver. I also hope that this will be a year for the state legislature to pass legislation to implement a roadmap to end hunger on college campuses. And I'm thrilled to see the work happening to implement the common application. Let's be the first state to fully close the SNAP gap. And while that work continues, there are things that can be done at the local level as well. Things like expanding access to culturally appropriate cooking classes, bringing gardens and hydroponics to every school, and more robust food recovery partnerships. All of this is going to require close collaboration. So groups like this one that's gathered here today are critical to making sure that the voices of those you serve are heard, and that these discussions that we are having are actually resulting in concrete actions. We need to make sure that we are closing all of the gaps that exist in our anti-hunger safety net. And just the final thing I'm going to say is that President Biden and Susan Rice, who's the head of the Domestic Policy Council, I mean, are really focused on this stuff, and as is the Secretary of Agriculture, Tom Vilsack. And I'm trying to get him to move quickly on expanding community eligibility when it comes to federal reimbursement for school meals. I mean, right now, as you know, if a school has up to 40% of the kids who rely on free or reduced lunch, they can cover the whole school. We want to get that down to at least 25%, or maybe even down to 20%. And if we could do that, and then the federal government could cover that, those schools, then I think it's a lot easier for Joe and Mindy and others to be able to make the case to their colleagues that the state should do the rest, because that would be a big chunk of it. But if we need to get this done like now, I'm trying to get the Biden administration to move quickly. I'll just say in closing, the way I look at this, because I'm in Congress and my life is in 2-year increments, and you know, I know what we have to deal with in the next year and a half. And that is, we have a Democratic Senate, we have a House that's problematic, but we have an administration that has a lot of discretion and that can do things even without the approval of the House. I don't know whether we have that after a year and a half, right? We don't know what happens in a year and a half. Maybe things get better. But I think we all should operate on the assumption that time is of the essence, that we ought to look at, you know, everything more urgently. And we ought to get as much done as we possibly can and get this administration to do as much as it possibly can, to get the state legislature to do as much as it possibly can in this next year and a half. And I will be wind at your back. I am like, you know, I am, you know, all jazzed up. I'm ready to, you know, I'm focused on this every day. And I'm meeting with some of the our private sector partners next week in Washington, trying to figure out ways that we can translate some of their profits into supporting some of the work that's happening here locally. I'll just say to everybody, I am so happy that to see all of you. This is absolutely beautiful to see all these people on a call, aimed at trying to figure out how we end hunger in this state once and for all. And we're going to do this. Failure is not an option here. But I'm grateful for all the feedback. I'm looking forward to hearing your comments and your advice. You tell me what to do on the local or state level. I will do it. I don't care if it's in my district or outside of my, I'll go anywhere. But we need to get this done. So I thank you very, very much. And I will yield back to my friend, Joe Comerford.
All right. Huge cheers for you. Failure is not an option, friends, says the huge wind at our back in the form of Jim McGovern. Jim, we love you so much. Thank you. That was so energizing. And welcome to MDAR Commissioner Ashley Randall, who's on. Many people know Ashley. This is another huge bit of good news, friends, that Ashley is at MDAR. Commissioner Randall is a gorgeous force and a great partner with Congressman McGovern and so many. Okay. So the congressman brilliantly laid out actually the arc of today. So we are about to move to hear from four folks for a couple minutes each about their impressions of the conference. And then we're going to hear directly from Aaron McAleer from Project Bread, who's leading a statewide movement to pick up on the White House conference and turn it into action steps at the state level. Then we'll hear from Phil Korman at CISA, who drives us here in the region, and of course, Winton Pitkoff, who helps also galvanize a statewide force. So now over to my good friend, Representative Mindy Dom.
Thank you so much, Senator Comerford and Congressman McGovern. I can't even express my gratitude enough to you, but I'm going to try for a moment. I'm going to slobber on some more gushing and just make sure you know that our families and friends who live outside of Massachusetts are incredibly envious of us because of our federal representation. You are the champion on so many issues, but especially on ending hunger. And I want to thank you not only for your efforts on getting the conference underway, but your incredible support for our district and for our constituents and for our most vulnerable residents. Thank you. So first, I just want to let folks know, and I want to make sure the 300 people that are here, I'm so thankful that you're here. And it's amazing that there are so many people who've come together on a Friday afternoon to talk about how to end hunger in our region and our Commonwealth. And I want to give a special hello to the organizations that are there that serve my constituents, the Amherst Survival Center and Neighbors Helping Neighbors through its partnership with Granby to Go and so many other friends. The conference was amazing. It confirmed the political will of the people who participated, but also the challenges and the work that we have left to do. So I'm going to briefly go through some takeaways that I had. And the first one was, just as the congressman said, we need to make universal free school meals in Massachusetts permanent. It's terrific that we extended it this year. It's wonderful that the legislature in the supplemental budget has included additional money to make sure it continues through the end of this academic year. But what we've learned about it, because we can look at what's happened during COVID as a pilot program, is how necessary it is and how important it is, not just for school communities and for families, but for the individual students who are going to school. So we need to make sure that that continues. We need to make sure it continues for every student in schools, and any effort that Congressman McGovern can do to increase the federal allocation for that effort is just going to make the legislature's ability to pass that a little bit easier. We also have to make sure that the HIP program and the momentum behind that program continues. It increases access to healthy, locally grown food. It's a win-win-win in Massachusetts for both people who are on SNAP, as well as our farmers, as well as people who are accessing it, their health. As one of the co-filers of the Hunger Free Campus bill, I appreciate Congressman McGovern's calling out student hunger and also trying to increase the eligibility of college students for SNAP. That bill is going to hopefully move in advance this session, and we're going to work really hard to make sure it passes. And there's so many people on this call who are working so hard to make that happen. I just want to shout them all out, including the Food Bank of Western Massachusetts. Two other things, though, that I learned was the importance of having personnel in schools to build these school-to-farm partnerships. We heard from people across the country, even folks from Alabama, who talked about their program works because they're in a position to make sure it works. They're reaching out from the school to the farming community, finding and sourcing the food that then their school lunches and school breakfasts can use. So it's not enough in some cases just to provide the funds for local food purchases, although that's critically important. Sometimes we have to make sure that there's capacity on the school side to be able to build, maintain, and use those relationships. And we also learned about the benefits of food literacy education for nutrition and advocacy. Representative Andy Vargas from Averill has filed a bill on this to incorporate it in K-12 schools, a really important bill. We know when students learn about food, not only do they choose more nutritious options, but they become advocates, and that's terrific. They learn the importance of making sure that there's equal access to nutrition. But I have to say that little line on the bottom is probably the biggest takeaway. And I just want to kind of contextualize it if I can, Senator. And that's that as the Massachusetts group was leaving and we were slapping ourselves on the back, you know, we've got universal free school meals, we're the best. And in fact, the Commonwealth is incredible. It is a leader in ending hunger. And Western Massachusetts, we are exceptional in that. We are the model for the Commonwealth. But then we bumped into Chef Jose from the World Central Kitchen. And as we're sort of saying, yeah, we're from Massachusetts, you know, the place that they have universal free school meals, he brought us down from our pedestal and said, yeah, that's what you should be doing. And it was like a breakthrough moment as just as we were feeling all proud, and we still have reason to be prideful about Massachusetts, but it also was like, yeah, our work is not done. We can feel pride, we can be bold, but we have to use it to build support for more efforts. And so I'm so happy to be here. I'm so looking forward to working with all of you to make that happen. And Congressman McGovern, our immense gratitude for your leadership, your fearlessness, and your just determination to say, this is something that can happen, we can make it happen, and accept no excuse for it not happening. You're a model. Thank you. Thank you, Senator.
Thank you, Representative. Next, we have the real great good fortune of hearing from Liz Wills Ogilvie. Sorry, Liz.
No worries, Senator Comerford. I have to add my gushing to all of my colleagues who helped make this possible. I'm just eternally grateful. And Representative McGovern, I so appreciate your proven efforts to support those outside of your district. When I was claiming you at the White House Conference on Hunger, folks kept saying, well, it's not really your Congress. And then I said, oh, but yes, he is, in ways that are too hard for me to articulate. And if I do, those who know me know I'll be in a puddle. So for me, I obviously care about every single thing we're going to talk about today. I serve on the Mass Food System Collaborative's advisory board, and the same for Mass Farm to School and a bunch of other stuff. And all of our work is centered in that. But my takeaway of being at the conference for me, who is still, while mature, a little Black girl from Springfield who was dependent upon commodities food before food stamps as we know it now it existed. And then our family's life improved when food stamps emerged out of the last conference. I was struck by the significance of the moment that I got to be there in that room and hear both President Biden and Secretary Vilsack make the comments that they did, really informed by a commitment to racial equity and racial equity needing to happen if the only way that we're going to eradicate hunger and improve health is by centering our work with a racial equity lens. We all lost so many during COVID, and far, far too many of those in Hampden County and across the state were due to food-related diseases that are completely preventable. And so HIP comes to mind. And I talked to hundreds of people about HIP while we were there as a tool, not only for meeting hunger needs, but improving nutrition needs. And for me, as a tool for racial equity, I would remind us all that HIP was seeded at BIPOC-led tables in Springfield years before it ever emerged as HIP. Certainly no one in this Commonwealth championed it like Frank Nochito did when he was at DTA, and he helped us to prove it in the soil of Springfield and Holyoke. The importance of universal school, free school meals is critical. We did it in Springfield before other cities did it across the Commonwealth. And even after we had it, the Food Policy Council advocated unrelentingly for it to be statewide. Systemic racism is rooted in agriculture. We're making progress, and we have to be the state that undoes it. So this was the first state to ratify slavery, and we can be the first state to undo the horrific history that came from that. All we have to do is be more intentional about centering Black, Indigenous, and other people of color in policy systems and environmental change strategies from the beginning, not as an afterthought. We have the muscle. Let's just put the will and get it done. Thank you.
Beautiful, Liz. Put the will, get it done. Thank you for leading us forward. And over now to Kirsten Levitt from the Stone Soup Cafe.
Wow, I'm overwhelmed just listening. Liz, I love and adore you. And as a girl who grew up in poverty in New York City, whose family also lived on food stamps and subsidies and lived with shame, I am so glad that you spoke your truth the way you did. My deepest gratitude to Congressman McGovern for even inviting us to the table and having us come to the conference. As someone who runs an emergency food program, we both do emergency meals as well as groceries and personal care items. It was overwhelming for me to be in the room, and the magnanimity of the moment was not lost on me. As a matter of fact, it probably took me 4 weeks before I even started processing. And quite frankly, I think it's going to take me another 6 months beyond this first six to really get down and deep. What really struck me was that it's not just government or nonprofits that is responsible for eradicating hunger in our nation and in our state. And when President Biden spoke, I heard him loud and clear speak to collaboration, to crossing over all kinds of sectors and our working together. And it was in that light that I picked up the phone or picked up my fingers and wrote an email to Senator Comerford to say, let's talk. And at the same time, Aaron from Project Bread was calling meetings as well. So Massachusetts, yes, we have a lot going on here and we do things really well, but we also didn't sit on our laurels. And I'm so proud of us for that. We have the potential for being the leader in showing how to collaborate, how to come out of our silos, how to talk about solutions that are not necessarily entrenched in institutional ways of solving problems, because we know that a lot of institutional entrenchment that happens also has a bunch of stigma that is all about values and devalues you because you're hungry, and how dare they. And so,
Kirsten, I'm sorry to interject, but as timekeeper, I'm just going to say, if you could wrap up, so we can move on to Anne, please. Thank you.
Yeah. And so, I just think we really are poised at this moment. And I will say, I think that children will be fantastic ambassadors as long as they really get health and nutrition education as well as healthy food. And I'll cede back the rest of my time. Thanks.
Thank you, Kirsten. And Zoe, thanks for keeping us moving. We really appreciate all of you. And now over to Ann Yeagle from Growing Places. Sorry, Ann, I just had a moment. Over to Ann Yeagle from Growing Places. And friends, just to get a sense, you know, Growing Places is more in the central part of Massachusetts. That's how we get to be stronger together. Ann is embodying that as a bridge.
Thank you, Senator Comerford. And we are very lucky to have been redistricted and have you as our senator now for part of North Central Mass, and always thankful to have Congressman McGovern as our fearless leader around food security at the federal level. So what I want to share a little bit about is we were really fortunate to have Secretary Becerra of Health and Human Services and Congressman McGovern come visit us before the White House conference to try and lift up some of the best practices at the intersection of health, nutrition, and agriculture. And so what I thought I would do is just share some of those things and just think about really these strategies have to bridge at the individual, institutional, and system level. And there's not one size that fits all, but I'd like you to think about what our strategies are in North Central Mass that took years and years to develop, lots of planning, assessment, conversations, listening, and uplifting and leveraging. And think about your region or where you're at and how you can adapt these, adopt these, and or are you already doing these? So very quickly, so I don't get the rope, if you see, the three topics are three of the pillars for the White House. And so one of the first things is really lifting up our institutions, working with our institutions and connecting them with farmers. And Joe mentioned us being the bridge. I think communities need that, institutions need that, and they need backbone organizations. And that's how Growing Places serves our region. Also, we've heard lots about the HIP program, but the HIP program, we know we need to close the HIP gap. There is a huge HIP gap still in our state. We are carrying over $8 million. There is no reason that messaging needs to be firmer, because we need to be able to advocate that we need more funding and level funding and not that we're carrying over money. Please increase awareness about the HIP program. Having registered dietitians and also culturally reflective staff at organizations, the intersection of professional and lived experience needs to be held at every single organization, every single program, every single strategy that we do. And then also working upstream, we are not just addressing things one individual at a time. How are we changing systems and structures that we're working on? And then lastly, creating infrastructure. We've heard about the FSIG program, all different things that exist in our state and at the federal level. We need to start to create infrastructure that bridges all of these sectors together. And that can look like tangible form, intangible form, people, things, equipment, but we need to start to do that. And so the last thing I will say is what I took away from the conference is we have the support of the federal government and our state government. Ask for what you need and get going. You need to be bold. And as the Congressman said, fight hard.
Thank you, Anne. I'm grateful for you. So thank you to the four speakers who really just gave us a sense of the excitement of the conference and the great deal of learning across really key issues. And now we're going to go directly to Aaron McAleer, who from Project Bread is going to tell us how we, thanks to Project Bread's leadership, are taking what we, the charge of the conference, and bringing it home. And these are strategies that we are going to use to get this call from the White House done. Over to you, Aaron.
Thank you, Senator Comerford. And I just want to echo comments made by earlier speakers of just the power of the moment. I never imagined I would be sitting in a room with the President of the United States, and certainly never imagined I'd be sitting in the room when he expressed that what I went through in my childhood was unacceptable, that food insecurity is unacceptable. And what I really appreciated about the plan that was put together by the White House is the focus on systemic solutions. When 21% of families in Massachusetts are food insecure and 33% of Black and Latino families in Massachusetts are food insecure, that is a systemic issue. And that requires systemic solutions. too often we focus on individualized solutions when it comes to this issue. And that's why I'm so grateful that the President of the United States put forward systemic solutions to addressing food insecurity. So echoing comments others made, Massachusetts is leading the way and doing a lot of incredible work. There are so many organizations, partners, coalitions moving forward on the solutions that were outlined in the plan. Immediately following the conference, we recognized there was an urgency, both with the legislature starting their new legislative session and with Governor Healey coming into the administration. So we brought together a small group of individuals who had attended the conference, including legislators, organizations leading policy coalitions, individuals with lived experience, to talk about what are the immediate priorities that we can put forward. So first we coalesced on five pillars, which are a little bit different than the ones that were included in the White House plan. I won't read these to you, but you can see what the five pillars that that group coalesced around. And then we agreed to get a letter to the legislature and to Governor Healey with the most urgent top priorities of actions that we felt needed to happen immediately. Those include in making free school meals for all permanent, robust implementation of the common application, making sure our families and individuals who are low income can easily access all available resources to them, investing in both tax relief and cash assistance for low income individuals, and fourth, having Governor Healey appoint a high level senior level administration official to coordinate all the work happening in the executive branch around this. We're really fortunate that the legislature is already working really proactively together. And I want to thank Senator Comerford for her leadership on the Massachusetts Food Systems Collaborative. But we felt really strongly that we also need the executive branch to have a leadership structure to bring together the various agencies. So those recommendations were put forward, and that was just the start. That was, again, responding to the urgency of the moment. We know we need to have a much bigger table, a much bigger tent to really think through the larger plan for ending hunger here in Massachusetts. And so that longer work is just getting started. Individuals with lived experience must be at the table, must be informing the strategy. All the wonderful organizations here, we want to hear your perspective, your voice, and again, really draft the plan based on the White House conference. So if you're interested in getting involved in that plan, I encourage you to reach out to Project Bread. I'll put an email in the chat, or one of my team members will, of an email that you can reach out to get involved. And we look forward to hearing your voices and hearing your perspectives. On the next slide, I'm going to talk about, you've heard about it a few times today, universal free school meals. Again, that was one of the top four recommendations that was put forward. I have some good news to share. Just moments ago, Governor Healey filed a supplemental budget to extend universal free school meals for the next school year. So that's an addition. She, a few weeks ago, filed a supplemental budget with the legislature, both the House and the Senate have passed, to extend it for this school year. But now she's signaling a commitment for next school year. And she's included language saying the Executive Office of Education has to put forward a plan to make it permanent. So some promising news, but there's a lot of work ahead. We need to make this a permanent policy. You know, 80,000 more kids are eating free school meals in October of this fall as compared to pre-pandemic because of this policy. There is a ton of momentum. We have over 150 organizations signed on to the coalition from lots of different sectors. 60% of the legislature is signed on, and that includes from all regions of the state and bipartisan support. But we need from legislators to hear this is a top priority, and we need the governor to hear it's a top priority. So really encourage you to get involved in this campaign. You can go to feedkidsmass.org. For example, we're probably going to be asking you to think Governor Healey for filing this. We want them to hear that this is a popular policy and that we need to continue with it. So lots of work ahead in the coming months to develop the Massachusetts state plan, but we want an early win here in Massachusetts to be universal free school meals. Minnesota is inching ahead of us. It looks like they're going to be sending that legislation to the governor's desk any moment now. I want Massachusetts to be the next state to make free school meals for all permanent. Thank you so much.
Yeah, what a beautiful win to bring to this gathering, Erin, and thank you for your leadership on this with so many great partners. It is a huge win. And friends, the reason this is a big win is that the price tag is not insignificant, as folks have noted. So the governor's saying, you know what, we're just going to take this out of your budget deliberations. I'm going to say The governor is going to say that this is going forward. It gives the legislature time to feel the heat that Aaron is talking about and figure out the plan with the Department of Education. So it's massive what Governor Healey has just done. She probably heard from the congressman and has heard from many others, many great advocates. All right. So now we're going to move to Laura from the food bank. And let me just thank Laura, Christina, Rep Dom, Christina also from the food bank, and others who worked on a survey to try to hear from the region what you're already doing. Remember what Liz said, there's already work happening in the five Western counties. We should make it visible, we should talk about it, and we should figure out how to do it even better. So over to Laura.
So thank you, Senator Comerford, and thank you, Aaron, for sharing that news. That is just an incredible thing to hear during this particular hour and a half. So I just want to really quickly talk about the survey that you all filled out as part of the registration process. We wanted to just get an idea of who's going to be in the room. So the first question that we asked was, of the following five pillars promoted in the conference, please check the pillars where your work or interest falls. And so you can see the answers here. And this slide was made when there were 251 registrants. We are now over 300, but this is still a good representation of what we have. So this big blue square was the bigger one, improve food access and affordability. This darker orange square was integrate nutrition and health. The smaller orange square was empower consumers to make and have access to healthy choices. The green is support physical activity for all. And the yellow is enhance. The yellow is empower consumers. So you can see we have a really nice representation, a really nice split between those five pillars represented here today. And then the next question we asked was, please tell us what best describes your work. And the options were food distribution, which is this big blue one, nutrition education, which is the orange, darker orange down under the blue. And then we have food security, advocacy, research, consumer education, food producer. And then the red one here is other. So there were a lot of people who said other. And I just put in the left-hand side here, just a few, very few of the other representatives here today. So with state reps, people who work in farming, education, housing, SNAP, community development, libraries, nonprofits, community school garden organizers. It's just so wonderful to have such a rich and diverse representation here today of people working in all the ways that food access touches us. So thank you so much for filling out the survey. And we're now gonna move on to Phil Corman from CESA, who's gonna talk about agriculture.
Thank you all, honored to be part of this panel. And I just wanna start by saying that the solution to hunger is not cheaper food. We have cheap food, and all it results in is a national food system that's run by a very small number of corporations that provide low-wage jobs, pays low prices to farmers for their harvests, and serves up processed food that's bad to our health, but good at filling you up and out. So I work with farms every day, and I want to tell you that local farms are under incredible stress. There's all this conversation about inflation, how it's affecting us all in our pocketbooks. And it affects small businesses like farms all the time. And it's very hard to farm year in, year out and make enough money to sustain the farm. But they have an additional challenge, which we all see around us, which is climate change. And the last two growing seasons, we saw a deluge of rain in 2021, a drought in 2022, and we've already seen the loss of our peach crop in 2023. Now, I want to add on to that how federal government policies often have only favored large farms since the Nixon administration and on. And that means that local family farms are all often giving the short end of the stick. But if you are a farmer of color, you don't even get to hold the short end of the stick. The USDA has a long documented history of racism, and recent attempts by the USDA to forgive loans to farmers of color was totally defeated in the courts. On an up note, in our state, we rank third in the nation for how much farms sell direct to consumers. And that is a beautiful thing, but we have so many people not able to access food grown in their communities. And the reason's obvious, our national and regional food systems are broken. So what we need is, we need those with money to choose local farms and to use more of their disposable income to buy food from the over 7,000 farms in our state. And for those who don't have enough resources, they need everything a civilized society should provide: a job that pays a living wage, transportation that works, affordable housing, childcare, and healthcare, and farms growing healthy food in their communities, regardless if they're rural, suburban, or urban. We've talked a little bit about SNAP. We know it expanded during the pandemic. We know it's now been cut. I think people on this video know about the fact that we do have programs that connect low-income folks to farms, such as the Farmers Market Nutrition Coupons. But I'm going to return back to HIP because that is our little gem that keeps growing in Massachusetts. And it started with a research study in one county in the nation, and that was Hampden County. And the study showed something obvious, that families will gladly buy and eat more produce if it's affordable and accessible. And based on that result of that study, there's now a USDA program nationally that states apply to participate in. And in our state, many of us pushed the Department of Transitional Assistance to submit that grant to the USDA and to craft this HIP program that provides for SNAP recipients another $40 to $80 of free produce. But I want to pause and just give a huge shout out to Gardening the Community in Springfield, because not only was it an important player over the last decade in designing and improving this program, along with the Springfield Food Policy Council, but also because it was an authentic voice for its Springfield community and consistently pushed the program to meet the needs of Black and Brown people, thereby helping all people in Springfield and the Commonwealth. So as we know, HIP accomplishes three things. It extends a household's food budget, proves the health status of families by giving them fresh produce, and it's allowed farms to sell more of their harvest locally in their region to people they were not reaching. And those monies, they all stay locally instead of having a Walmart suck it right out of our communities. We know how hard it is for families on SNAP to get their benefits, but you may not know it's not easy at all for farms to participate in SNAP or HIP. We know that at CESA because we've helped over 150 farms, markets, and nonprofits to help them access these programs, get authorization from DTA, get the needed equipment, train the staff, and learn how to respect people who may look a little different than them. And we've tried very hard to share what we've learned with other groups across the state. And as been mentioned, despite all the work we've all done in this community and the state, we still only have 5% of households on SNAP using HIP statewide. I want to thank everybody, and I think I pass it on to Whitten, who will be sharing more budgetary and legislative actions we can take.
Thank you, Phil. Thanks to the work of everybody on this call, there are some really remarkable progressive pieces of legislation for all of us to be working on this session. I'm not going to talk through every one of them here because I've been assigned the very important task of keeping us on time. But the bills that you see here do everything from making sure that kids learn about food in school, teaching them about nutrition, teaching them about the food system job opportunities for when they graduate, teaching them about how to read a label and how food marketing targets them, usually unfairly, to bills that encourage donation to help reduce the amount of wasted food in the state, a bill that would encode HIP into law so that it is no longer as fragile as it is, and bills that help farmers meet that, close that gap that Phil was talking about. Farmers make less money than they spend producing the food for us. And we need smart food system policy in the state to help farmers, things like farmland protection and other policies that help farmers produce food more sustainably and more efficiently. There's also a number of budget items that are important this session. There's going to be a budget item proposed as the budget goes through the legislature that would fund a food literacy pilot project. Obviously, HIP continues to be a budget priority for us, and we're asking for level funding of $24 million again this year. And I invite everyone to join us at HIP Lobby Day at the State House on May 9th. I'll put a link in the chat to sign up for that. And we were very excited to see that Governor Healey included food security infrastructure grants in her budget. This was the first time that the FSIG program was included in the operating budget. So it's not just being left to bond funding or to federal funding as available, but something that she says she wants to make permanent. And those grants have been an absolute game changer for farmers in really helping to close some gaps for them and allowing them to purchase infrastructure that keeps them sustainable over the long term. We're not going to be able to get into a full-scale advocacy training today, but I'm going to put a link in the chat that will connect you with all kinds of resources about how to reach out to legislators. Right now is a great time to call legislators and email them and encourage them to co-sponsor the bills that you care about. And you'll hear more from us in the coming months about the budget. And then as we get later into the year, there's definitely going to be opportunities to submit testimony on all of these bills. So I will turn it back over to Senator Comerford.
Thank you, Phil and Winton, so much for this pointed advocacy. We're going to send out a follow-up email, friends. So we'll collect, thanks to Zoe and Laura, we'll collect all of this information and we'll make sure that you get it so that you can use your human power to advocate for these priorities from Project Red and from Phil and from Winton, all forces of nature. Speaking of forces of nature, I'm going to turn it over to Laura Sylvester from the Food Bank for the third or fourth, actually, tranche of advocacy, and then we'll open it up to your thoughts and questions.
Thank you, Senator. So you've heard of some really great legislation that is currently happening in our state that we should all be proud of and that we should all be working towards. I'm just going to talk about a few more things. The first is an act establishing the Massachusetts Hunger Free Campus Initiative. You've heard Congressman McGovern mention this, and also Rep. Dom, who is one of the main sponsors of this legislation, along with Rep. Andy Vargas and Senator Joan Lovely. So Massachusetts is known as the best state in the country for higher ed, yet 37% of our public college students are food insecure. These numbers are even higher for students who are Black, Latinx, LGBTQ, and student parents actually have the highest food insecurity rates of all at 54%. It's unacceptable. And then of those students who are food insecure, only about 20% of them are even utilizing programs like SNAP, because most students don't even realize that they're eligible for SNAP. And then when you add onto that the high cost of food, gas, housing, budgets are just being strained, and it's really hard for people to stay in school and complete their degrees. And then, you know, if they drop out, they get tons of debt. So this legislation would prevent that from happening. The Hunger Free Campus Initiative creates a grant program at the Department of Higher Ed in Massachusetts to support campuses taking steps to end food insecurity on campus. So schools can receive funding for things like creating awareness and anti-stigma campaigns, notifying students of federal food assistance benefits such as SNAP and WIC, establishing on-campus EBT SNAP vendors, operating meal sharing programs, providing schools with training and resources, and allowing them to hire additional staff. So last year, we were able to secure $3.8 million in ARPA funding to jumpstart this initiative. So right now, there are a number of schools in Massachusetts who have received some grant funding to do just this. This legislation would make that program permanent and allow us to continue to support these schools and these students. And I just want to point out that there's a lobby day happening March 30th at the State House. When we send out the follow-up email, you'll get the link to be able to register for that lobby day. We really hope to see you there. Next thing I want to mention is an act to increase regional transit accessibility in the Commonwealth. You may not think that transportation has anything to do with hunger, but in fact, lack of access to reliable transportation is a major cause of food insecurity. And especially in Western Massachusetts, where we know we do not have robust public transportation, this is a huge problem. So this legislation is sponsored by Rep. Natalie Blay, who's from Western Mass, and Senator Susan Moran. So in Massachusetts, there are 15 regional transit authorities throughout the state. They are a lifeline to residents in the 250 communities who are outside of the MBTA area. They help connect people to jobs, groceries, medical care, and more. But funding for these regional transit authorities is extremely inequitable compared to funding for the T. This bill would change that, and we really hope you will support that. It increases the funding floor of RTAs from $90 million to $150 million, does a bunch of other really good things too that I won't get into. But I will say that there is also a lobby day for this bill as well, April 20th at the State House, and we'll send out information about how to show up for that. If you have any interest at all in transportation, please do reach out and get more information about that. The last thing I want to mention is MEFAP, which stands for Massachusetts Emergency Food Assistance Program. This is funding that the state gives to the four food banks to distribute to our member agencies and meal sites. It ensures a consistent supply of quality, nutrient-dense foods and locally grown fresh produce is available to anyone who needs it. In Western Massachusetts, there are 166 food pantries and meal sites, including Stone Soup Kitchen and Cafe, that receive MEFAP food. In fiscal year 22, our food bank distributed just over 12 million pounds of food, nearly 40% of which was purchased through MEFAP. So you can see it's a really important source for our region. For this next coming year, we're going to be increasing our MEFAP budget ask from $30 million to $41.5 million. And the reason why we're asking for more is because of the SNAP emergency allotments, which ended last week. That's going to impact 113,000 households in Western Mass who just received their last payment. The average household here is going to lose $164 a month in SNAP benefits. We all know SNAP benefits are barely enough. Most people cannot make it through the month with what they have. Losing that is going to create a huge hunger cliff. Big problem. People are going to need to turn elsewhere for support. We're going to assume that this is going to put a big strain on the emergency food network starting next month. So we're going to need more to address that. MEFAP also does support farmers and producers throughout the state, so it's a win-win there. And while we're working to end hunger in the long term, we really need to be able to meet the need in the short term. So with that, we've heard some great work being done throughout the state to address hunger. We really invite you to join us. We all work closely together as anti-hunger advocates. We welcome you. We would love to have more people in our tent. Thank you so much for being here today. I'm going to turn it back over to Senator Comerford, and we're going to stop screen sharing and open up for questions and comments.
Beautiful. Thank you all so much. Friends, I just want to recognize that Representative Natalie Blay has been with us, and Rep. Blay has been acknowledged as a leader on so many of these issues we care about. Thank you, Natalie. Also, the Office of Bud Williams is here. Thank you to the representative who leads so much. If I've missed an office and I didn't see it, please do, you know, flag it and so we could celebrate you. And also just friends, President Christina Royal is here from Holyoke Community College. President Royal has made us all so much smarter on food insecurity and hunger on college campuses and has led us to be better at our jobs. So thank you, President Royal, for your work. Now, thanks to Zoe and Laura, we've collected some great ideas and questions from the chat. We'll start there and then we'll open it up. And anybody can jump in to answer. We'll figure out how to traffic cop that a bit.
Yeah, Zoe, there's been some great questions in the chat, everybody. And the one that I think I'll first bring up is a question from Susan Wargaftic. I'm sorry if I'm mispronouncing your last name, but Susan brings up a good question about food access for the unhoused or recently unhoused and how food access in general intersects with housing. And she asked, on collaborations, how can we build in healthy food to our housing programs? And there's been some mutual aid going on in the chat, but I think that we should bring that out for a more general conversation.
Terrific. Thanks, Susan, and thanks, Zoe, for that great characterization. Does anybody want to jump in to offer thoughts about that tie?
I can share, Senator Comerford, on a more system level. I think I'd love to hear from community organizations on more immediate solutions. But one of the things that Massachusetts is leading on with the Medicaid waiver is to address both housing and food insecurity as a social determinant of health. And I just think that's a really important, that's an example of something Massachusetts is leading on. I know the Food Bank of Western Mass, like Project Bread, we have a case management model where we're serving patients who are identified as food insecure. And I believe, and I'll let the Food Bank of Western Mass speak, but they're addressing housing for their patients as well. So as we're looking towards like what systemic solutions out there for food insecurity and for housing, I think leveraging Medicaid and looking at how do we integrate housing and food and nutrition supports into the healthcare system is an example of how do we really holistically and systemically at a large scale address both of these issues.
And I can jump in as well because I offered to pull a group together. I'm from the Health Equity Partnership for North Central Mass, and we do have a group that is planning a cliff effect proposal that will work with our housing authorities and the support systems that will help people get out of systemic long-term poverty. And so that will, we can incorporate food access into that plan. We've already started looking at how transportation works with that plan, child care, job training, education access, all of those things. So we'll connect.
Thanks, Chelsea. Laura, did you want to speak to the food bank's engagement? I know Erin raised it.
Christina, do you want to jump in?
Yeah, great.
Sure. Hi, everyone. I'm Christina Maxwell with the Food Bank of Western Mass. So as Erin mentioned, we are part of the 1115 waivers that Massachusetts has to tie healthcare into food insecurity and housing security issues. So we work with healthcare providers who send us referrals of their patients who have screened as being food insecure. We work with them to address those issues. And then we're able to pass on referrals to other organizations, including Wayfinders, for people who may be facing housing insecurity, as well as a variety of other issues, childcare issues, job training, et cetera, et cetera. And that is, as I said, a waiver right now. It's a pilot program. But we are really hoping that that will become a more permanent program and spread to other states throughout the country. Right now, it's just Massachusetts and Oregon that are piloting this program, but I think the success of it is becoming evident. So hopefully it will be able to spread across the country as well.
Beautiful. Thank you so much, all of you. Zoe, do you want to characterize another question?
Yes, sure. Louise asked a great question, which was, do any of these efforts serve farm workers, many of whom are immigrants? Nothing seems so unjust to me to learn that farm workers cannot afford healthy food for their families.
Absolutely. Phil, can I put you on the spot to address this? It's a great question.
Oh, you're on mute, Phil.
Oh, we got to get you unmuted.
I'm sorry, I got distracted for 1 second. Just repeat the question for me.
Yeah, sure. The question's about, do any of these efforts serve farm workers, many of whom are immigrants? There's many farm workers who can't afford healthy food for their families.
So I think the one victory we've had in the past year was getting driver's licenses for folks who did not have all the documentation, despite the fact having children who are citizens and totally engaged in their communities. And great work was done by a lot of advocacy immigrant groups. In terms of food access to local food, I think that remains a challenge. And I think it's work that we need to really focus on to ensure that people who are harvesting food, working on farms, also have that ability to buy food for themselves. And then we have individual farms providing solutions, but that's not a structural change.
And I would just add that I think it's worth promoting SNAP. There certainly are immigration restrictions with SNAP, but refugee victims of human trafficking are immediately eligible. So I think often the assumption is that there's no eligibility based on your immigration status. Children are always eligible for SNAP regardless of immigration status. So encourage you to continue to promote. Project Bread has a website, gettingsnap.org, our food source hotline. I know Food Bank of Western Mass does incredible SNAP outreach as well, but at least finding out eligibility, that it's not necessarily certain, but I think sometimes the assumption is completely being ineligible, but getting on the phone with a counselor at Project Bread or the Food Bank of Western Mass and talking through everyone in your household, the immigration status, the refugee status of everyone in your household, there may be opportunities to leverage SNAP and then obviously leverage HIP.
And of course, more work to shore up the economic realities of farms and farm workers for sure, right? There's a whole lift all boats that we have to do. Zoe, do we have another question that we should characterize? I see Phoebe Walker has her hand up.
We do have a couple, but I think let's kick it to Phoebe because since your hand's up.
Okay, thank you. Then we'll come back.
Super quickly, I'm here wearing my hat in this moment as a board member of the Community Health Center of Franklin County, and just want to flag for the farm worker conversation that the Community Health Center has a farm worker outreach program that spans the entire valley. And I think it would be really great to connect, as if someone is sort of taking on leading that particular piece forward, to loop in. I don't see folks from the program here on the call, but just want to say that whole conversation about bringing, taking responsibility for the health of farm workers and bringing resources together, bringing things out to farms. I think they'd be a really willing and excited partner to work on that.
Can I jump in as a board member of the group that funds that project?
Yes, thank you.
The League of Community Health Centers. I think that community health centers, certainly Franklin County as well as mine, are part of a Medicaid ACO, which most farm workers nowadays actually, a lot of them are seasonal, not migratory. And so they are a part of the Medicaid program. And under the new Medicaid program, there's a lot more support for flexible supports for food. And so I am going to say that I assume, and I am very sure that the outreach workers of the Franklin County program are connecting folks as they can with those supports. Again, Massachusetts sort of as a leader. Last week in Washington, people were like, whoa, the idea of Medicaid dollars for food, but Massachusetts is already doing it through our ACOs. So I think that there is something there, but I think absolutely reach out to them if you want to learn more about that.
Super. Thank you, Phoebe. Thank you, Eliza, for chiming in. Super important to remember all of this. I just want to recognize that Representative Tricia Farley Bouvier is here. Tricia, I saw Tricia. I didn't know it was Rep. Farley Bouvier. We're so happy to have you. Thank you for your leadership. And you have a question or a comment?
Yeah, I just want to let people know that advocacy really works. So when you're given these directions by the leaders, in these sectors to advocate, it really does work. And here's some very concrete evidence of this through the leadership of Rep. Mindy Dom and Natalie Blay and Andy Vargas. The 62-member House Progressive Caucus has made food insecurity its number one priority in this year's budget. That includes HIP, MEFAP, and universal school meals. It was overwhelmingly voted on as the number one, like by far. And it's the first time it has been even entered into, like we're a pretty Democratic group, if I'm gonna tell you the truth. And so we'll be advocating strongly for that. But it's because members heard from their own community and they're learning from you on the ground what it looks like. So please keep doing that. It really does make a difference. Thank you very much, Joe, for this really inspiring afternoon. I really appreciate it.
It's really gorgeous. And it was a total team effort, Tricia. Really like totally democratically organized. And big love to you for the driver's license bill, my sister. President Royal, we see you.
Yes, hello. First of all, thank you, Congressman McGovern, for all of your advocacy on the federal level, and certainly Senator Comerford, Rep. Dom, and others on our state level. So I wanted to mention that Holyoke Community College was able to become the first community college in the state to have SNAP designation, to be able to offer SNAP benefits, accept them at our college store on campus. And there's still a lot of barriers at the federal level. And I really love to see some advocacy to remove some of this so that it was easier for colleges and universities to be able to accept SNAP benefits on college campuses. There's a lot of internal hurdles in terms of going through the application process. And also the federal government requires you to have the store up and running before you can even essentially get someone to come out and do the designation to review it for you, which is the antithesis of being able to really sort of gain some financial support with through our legislators and other vehicles to be able to create the conditions to get a store up and running. There's also some different requirements about what needs to be in the store that is incongruent with what students are wanting to use their SNAP benefits for and that are allowed in other places, but not higher ed environments. And so I'd love to see sort of continued advocacy and work in this realm, because if we could get all 15 community colleges across the state to have a SNAP designation to accept it, this would really help when we are one important ecosystem across the state of where individuals who have these types of benefits are going to community colleges. And it's a perfect example of the intersectionality of issues we're talking about on this, about needing to work across agencies with the food banks and the community colleges and, you know, our legislators, et cetera. So thank you so much for providing this platform and for the Food Bank of Western Mass for hosting this. Yeah.
Please, Jim. Yeah.
No, President Roll, I hear you, and we will reach out to you. Making SNAP more accessible for college students was one of the items in the national strategy, and is one of my priorities as we approach this farm bill. The Republicans are writing the bill in the House, but we Democrats are writing in the Senate. But we're going to try to figure out whether we can find some common ground with some of the Republicans. On that, but we'll reach out to you just to kind of make sure we're all clear on what some of the hurdles are that you're dealing with. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you. And we're happy to support your office in anything, including some of the experiences that we had to go through in that application process. Thank you.
And we just have to give a shout out to Dr. Royal and Holyoke Community College, because they are the first and still only community college or college of any sort in the state to have a market that accepts SNAP EBT benefits, and are generously sharing their best practices with other schools and trying to make that happen in other schools across the state. And Dr. Royal has been a valued part of the Hunger Free Campus Coalition since day one. You do so much for your students, and we love you. Thank you.
Oh, it's beautiful. We do love you. And friends, just as, you know, what President Royal is talking about, right, this intersectionality that I see the chat all lit up about is so true, right? As the governor wants to break down barriers to entrance for community college, and the Senate president's talking about free community college, well, then let's make sure that doorway is total cost of education, which means food, and it means transportation. In addition to just making college affordable in dollars and cents. So wonderful. Zoe, I'm going to turn it back to you to see if we could characterize more from the chat, the beautiful chat.
Sure. Yeah, I would say that one theme that seems to be emerging as I'm sifting through the chat, Emma asked this earlier and said, I'm wondering if there's any work going on relating to food systems and mental health, specifically eating disorders. And I'll also say relatedly, Caitlin also just brought up about how we talk about food and we talk about nutrition and how fat bias oftentimes shapes a lot of the ways that we frame these things and how do they intersect and what's a way to characterize, you know, nutrition and food access for all while considering these factors.
So important. Who wants to jump in on this? Thank you for these two really important calls to action.
I'm happy to speak a little bit on it, but welcome others. I mean, I think the connection with mental health is so important to recognize. I'm a social worker by training, and the reality is when you can't meet your most basic of human needs and you can't meet the most basic of human needs for your kids, food insecurity is a contributing, there is a direct correlation between food insecurity and mental health, which is another reason we absolutely need to be addressing the food insecurity crisis. On the nutrition piece, I think an important, argument I often make is that we need to improve nutrition of everybody in the United States of America. And we need to move the conversation away about low-income individuals only, and move away from, you know, restricting what people on SNAP can purchase or what low-income families are allowed to have access to. And instead talk about, you know, subsidies for food across the country. And that's a position that we at Project Bread feel really strongly about. Yes, let's have the conversation about nutrition and health and how do we improve the diet of all Americans and move away from restricting what can be purchased specifically by low-income Americans.
Thank you, Erin. I see Caitlin has her hand up.
Yeah, I just wanted to respond to that too. I did put in the chat, there is an act relative to body size discrimination that's been introduced in the legislature for the second session in a row. It's not something that I see show up a lot when we talk about the food system and what legislation we're supporting, but I think it should be in there. I think that also, it's really important that we focus on the systemic factors that are impacting people's choices. I think it can be, without like a pedagogy around how we like approach conversations about people's individual nutrition choices that takes, the harmful effects of things like weight cycling and eating disorders into account, then I think we really need to like be focusing on the systemic factors and thinking about, what is the framing that we want to embrace as a state for those conversations.
Super important. Thank you. I think what we're seeing is another intersection, right? Intersecting with mental health and with conversations about nutrition, conversations about access to outdoor spaces for exercise and healthy living, like all of these and transportation, all of these are connected. I see two hands up, and then I think that they may be the two hands that close us out. First over to you, Liz, and then Lev.
Thank you, Senator. This is a tough conversation for me. I totally get the body shaming and all of that, but the reality of life in Springfield is that there is a Popeye's fried chicken, a Kentucky fried chicken, a Chester's fried chicken, all within 6 blocks of each other. My husband teaches in Longmeadow. They do not have one fast food restaurant. So, and this is not the food that people of African descent and Latinx descent naturally ate. It's the food that makes a lot of money for my city because of drive-thru restaurants. So we have to have like 6 trains running at the same time and be talking about what as a state can we do to influence our municipalities to not just chase these big tax dollars. Because frankly, if Gardening Community had 3 farm stores on the same street, I'd be selling a whole lot of collard greens.
Thank you, Liz. Thank you. I think that's really important. Lev beautifully just said Liz has the last word, that's a beautiful way to end. Thank you, Lev, thank you, Liz. So friends, we have miraculously come to 2:28. Here's what's going to happen. This was held by a big group of folks. I just get to make some of the connections, but really the folks and the groups that I talked about in the beginning and you heard from today are the people who sort of came together, and we came together in part because Congressman McGovern helped us get access to this gorgeous conference, right? So that's how we know each other in this space. And we did so thanks to the huge umbrella of the food bank. So we are going to take the chat, we're going to take the survey responses, we're going to take the slides, we're going to take all of the calls to action, and we're going to package it all up. and send it out so that we as this force from Western Massachusetts with Jim's wind at our back are going to really take on the work that has been beautifully articulated today in all its complexity and all its intersections. Anybody else want to sort of say goodbye from the group of folks, including you, Congressman, if you want to say goodbye and sort of help frame us as we head out to the work ahead?
Yeah, well, again, I thank you all for being on this call, and thank you for your commitment and all the things that you do. You know, I as we were talking here, I kept on thinking of some of the places that I visited and some of the models that I think, you know, some of the things I've seen that could be models for the rest of the country. I was in New York City a week ago with Hakeem Jeffries, and he asked me to come to his district to see some work that AmeriCorps is doing with some of the housing authorities in Brooklyn, basically creating gardens on the sites of these housing authorities because there aren't supermarkets nearby. And so people don't have access to the fresh fruits and vegetables. And, you know, and so they've created these gardens that AmeriCorps is kind of overseeing. But, you know, in order for you to be able to get some of the food from the garden, you have to participate in the composting program that they have. And so everybody now is composting their food, he said, which is great because it's also dealing with some of the rat problems that they've had, which is garbage laying around. Anyway, there's all these incredible, like, models that really can be replicated, even in our schools. I mean, you know, we need to teach nutrition. People need to know what good food is. People need to know how to cook. People have to cook. If you can cook, you can actually save money and you can control what you put into the food. So there's a lot that needs to be done in a variety of systems, the health system, the education system, whatever. But there's, you know, what's happening here in Massachusetts and what the people on this call represent really is incredible. And I feel even more hopeful that this White House conference is going to be transformational because of the work that's going on here. But we want to work with all of you. And to the state legislators, thank you for all that you're doing. And so this is not the end. This is a continuation of this conversation. And we're gonna follow Jose Andres's admonition and not pat ourselves on the back too much because we have a lot that we need to do. But thank you, Joe, and thank you to everybody.
Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you, Congressman, for singing us out. Friends, this concludes this great gathering. Again, thank you so much to the Food Bank and to CISA for helping be the infrastructure today. And you'll hear from us as soon as we send that follow-up email. Take good care, everybody.